वेलकम गाइस, वेलकम टू द डिस्कशन ऑन द बजट। आई एम श्योर ऑल ऑफ यू हैव सीन और एटलीस्ट रेड अबाउट द बजट दिस ईयर। इट वॉज प्रेजेंटेड लास्ट वीक, इनफैक्ट इन द मिडल ऑफ द वीक, एंड आई एम श्योर ऑल ऑफ यू वुड हैव रेड वेरियस ओपिनियंस, वेरियस एक्सपर्ट्स रिव्यूज अबाउट द बजट, राइट? सो आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू गो थ्रू द वर्बैटिम अनाउंसमेंट्स, रादर आई वॉन्ट टू डिस्कस विद यू what are the major changes which have happened, what are the major announcements which have been made and their impact. So I want to discuss the pros and cons, I want to discuss the implications, I want to discuss the impact of this budget rather than just giving you verbatim the announcements, right? Meanwhile, if you have any questions, meanwhile if you have any queries regarding anything, please put it in the chat box, okay? So overall guys, please tell me, how do you think is the budget, your opinion of the budget, the good points, the bad points, whatever you want to say, please put it in the chat box. I want to know your overall opinion about the budget. Any problems? All of you seem to be pointing out the good parts about the budget. Any problems, any shortcomings? Right, we'll talk about labor laws and we'll talk about banking. Okay, fine. Bullet train, theek hai ji, we'll talk about bullet trains also. What about FDI, Abhinav? What, so has something specific been announced regarding FDI or something has been omitted? What do you want to say about FDI? Right, right. Sure. So we'll talk about that also. Okay. So overall, if you were to take my opinion on, you know, my first impression, my overall overarching view of the budget, I would say it's a fairly good budget, right? And if I were to identify a single theme, right, a single theme coming out of this budget, a broad area where I can say that, you know, if I can give a phrase, this budget, I would say it's a Robin Hood budget, right? In my opinion, it's a Robin Hood budget. The central theme which is coming out for me is take from the rich and give to the poor, right? And that's the theme that I'll also explain this as we go along. So in my opinion, the central theme, even though nothing groundbreaking, nothing earth shattering has been done, so these are all incremental decisions that they have taken, the announcements have not been very big in nature. So, but overall, whatever announcements have been there have largely been take from the rich, give to the poor, right? So even though there's nothing wrong with that, it's a Robin Hood kind of a budget. Okay, now let's look at the budget announcements one by one. First of all, let's talk about the fiscal side. So since I think somebody mentioned the fiscal deficit, I think that is one of the areas we need to talk about first, right? So everybody understands what is fiscal deficit, right? So let me quickly take you through that. So in India, you have a law called the FRBM Act. So what is this FRBM Act? So the FRBM Act was enacted in 2003, and as per this act stands for Fiscal Responsibility and Budgetary Management. As per this act, the government was supposed to maintain fiscal discipline. Okay, what is the meaning of fiscal deficit discipline? It means the government must keep a tight check on the ratio of its expenses versus its incomes, right? So now let us talk about the government's expenses and incomes, right? I'm sure all of you know, just like any company, just like any anybody doing business, in fact, even your own home, at home, you would all have incomes and expenses, right? So let us have a look at the income and expenses of the government of India, right? So if I put expenses on this side and incomes on this side, can somebody tell me what is India's GDP? Right, so so varying figures, but the one which I am aware of is $2.3 trillion, or close to $2.3 trillion. Can you quickly translate this into rupees? Since all our numbers are going to be in rupees, I want you to tell me, what does this translate into rupees? Rupees, guys. Nitesh, what 160? What is this 160? So translate into rupees, calculating by a rate of, let's say, 67 rupees to a dollar. Let's take the rate of 67 rupees to a dollar. Right. So approximately India's GDP is 150 lakh crore rupees. 150 lakh crore rupees is India's GDP. Okay, so just keep this figure in mind and then we'll look at the budget financials from this perspective. Okay. Now, let's look at incomes first. What are the income heads for a government? Where does it get income from? Yes, guys, quickly. Absolutely. The first and biggest source of income for any government is taxes, right? And taxes, as we all know, are indirect and direct, right? And combined, the projection is that in the year 1718, the government of India will get a tax revenue of 12.5 lakh crore rupees. This is the projected tax revenue for the government of India for the coming year. Okay. Now, similarly, we have other heads of income for the government, right? Okay, Pranay Kaustubh, I'll talk about that first. Borrowing is never income. Borrowing is a source to balance expenses and income. You borrow to meet your expenses. Borrowing is never an income. Okay. Similarly, exports Kaustubh is not an income. Never. Exports is income for the organization doing the exports. Government does not do any exports. Okay. So Kaustubh, please be clear. Vipul, excise import duty is part of indirect taxes. Yeah. So Kaustubh, there are government organizations like, for example, MMTC, right? State Trading Corporation, STC, and MMTC, Metals and Minerals Trading Corporation, government organizations who do exports, but those exports are their revenue, their income, not income of government of India. Similarly, if SBI has certain income, it is SBI's income. SBI is a separate entity, government of India is a separate entity. SBI's income is not government income. What kind of foreign funds, Shreya? Again, there is a problem here. Yeah, Chaitanya, same question. What kind of investment? So if Walmart comes in and sets up outlet in India, it is not income for the government of India. Not at all. FDI, FPI are not income for the government of India. No. Forex, yes, but Forex is not income. Forex is reserves. So when they bring in dollars, those dollars go to the reserves, not to income. Yes. So again, what grants? Yuvraj, yes, they do add to GDP, but not to government income. What is this grants? So grants, again, I'm going back to grants. Grants are not income. Grant kaun deta hai? Okay, reserves. Okay. So again, when any foreign company brings in foreign currency to India for the purpose of investment, or when an exporter exports something and again dollars come in as payment, those dollars cannot be transacted in India. You cannot use them for buying and selling stuff. So therefore, those dollars are given to a bank, and against them you take rupees, right? Those dollars flow from the banks to the RBI, and the RBI maintains foreign currency as reserves. Reserves for what? One, these are guarantees of government debt, right? And two, these are used for import payments. So whenever payments are need to be done in foreign currency, in dollars, they are done from these reserves, right? So theoretically, yes, if the government of India gave loans to other countries, and you know, so that was the situation, we would get interest on that, but practically that is not the case. We are not net interest givers, we are net interest payers, because we take loans rather than we give loans. So theoretically, yes, Spandan, yeah, so we actually take loans and therefore pay interest. We don't actually give loans. So we are not loan positive, we are loan negative. Yes, so I'll come to that auction of resources, that I'll come to. Okay, so again, taxes is the biggest head of revenue. The second head of revenue is non-tax. Please note this carefully, guys. Non-tax revenue income. I'll explain this in a minute. Non-tax revenue income. This figure is 2.5 lakh crores, projected to be 2.5 lakh crore rupees from this. What is this? This is largely dividends coming in from government owned businesses. Government owned organizations do business. When they do business, they earn income, they earn profits, and out of that, they give dividends to their owners. So an SBI will work, will earn money, will earn profit, will give dividend to its owner. Owner is primarily government of India. Similarly, RBI will give its profit as dividend to its owner, or part of that profit. So when government owned organizations earn profit, they give a part of that profit to their owners as dividend. That is non-tax revenue income for the government of India, right? Yeah, so all PSUs, all government sector undertakings, wherever government has a stake, wherever government is a part owner or a full owner, whenever they earn profit, they may give a dividend. Just like any company gives dividend to its owners, they may also give dividends to their owners, which are largely government of India. So that is, no, Pratika, no, absolutely not. This is not divestment. I'll come to that. That is non-tax revenue income. Please note, revenue income. You also have capital income. So now there are two heads. Okay, earlier, if you remember, the budget used to have plan and non-plan expenditure. Now we have revenue and capital expenditure. Similarly, we have revenue and capital receipts or incomes. Okay, so revenue receipts are those incomes which are of general business nature, operating nature. So taxes, dividends. So by working, doing your normal work, whatever income you get, that is revenue income. Capital income is those incomes of the government which are primarily received by selling assets, right? When the government sells part of its ownership in public sector companies, right, which is also called divestment, that is a capital income. Similarly, when government sells national resources like spectrum, like coal mines, right? So spectrum sale, telecom spectrum. So when you sell either national assets or part ownership in government companies or PSUs, these are called capital incomes. They are of this nature. No, Shoaib, how is repo rate a revenue here? Repo rate is the rate that RBI charges from banks for loans it gives. That will be a source of income from RBI, not for government. Yuvraj, RBI cannot transfer any income to government. RBI can only give dividend to government. Right? So that is above in the second heading on the page. Shreya, selling of spectrum means selling of airwaves, which are used by the telecom sector. So yeah, so this amount, cost of dividend ka answer aapko diya hai aapke pehle jab aapne pucha. Adarsh has given you your answer. Yeah, just look at the chat. Yes, so I don't know the figure, Yuvraj, but they will transfer it in the shape of dividend. Okay, so this amount projected for the next year is close to 72,000 crore. So this is 0.72 lakh crore, in other words, less than 1 lakh crore, 72,000 crores. Okay ji, so now what we are saying is the government earns income from taxes, dividends, and by selling stuff. So you can do your business. That means the government can earn income from taxes. Taxes can be customs duty, can be service tax, sales tax, excise, all types of taxes. Taxes can be corporate tax, taxes can be income tax. Non-tax revenues are dividend, and then you have sale of assets. These are all the sources of divestment. Others is basically when government sells part of its ownership in public sector companies to others. What do you mean, which one is bigger? Okay, so income tax, direct taxes are those taxes which are directly levied on the income. Okay, direct taxes are levied on income of individuals and corporates. So you have corporate income tax, you have individual income tax, right? So that is what we mean by direct taxes. Capital income, Tapan, again is income which is coming from sale of assets. That is capital income. And divestment is by selling of part of ownership in a public sector company. Spectrum sale is when you sell, that is just an example, when you sell natural resources. So for example, the government sells its coal mines. Coal mines or metals and minerals found under the ground are government's natural resource. So anything, suppose you if you live in a house, let us say tomorrow there is digging which happens and there is oil found under the land of your house. That, so the property belongs to you, but that natural resource which is found under that land is not yours. It belongs to the government. Okay, even though the property is lost yours, it is found under your land, even then all metals, all minerals found under the property of India belong to the government. So when government sells that is a capital income. AK, these figures are for 17-18. These are not outdated. This is for the coming year. This is what the budget has said will be for the coming year. So Shreya, when UN or anybody else invests in a particular project in India, that is not an income for the government, na? Government ki income nahi hoti wo. So Vibhor, if you want that breakup of taxes, you have to check the budget document. Yeah, I'm just giving you a rather more macro picture. So again, I can check that for you. I'm sure you can check that yourself as well. Okay? So this is the three major heads of incomes. Let's come to the other side, which is the expenses side. What are the expenses of the government of India? So again, I'll give you a classification on different heads in terms of the value, right? The biggest head, right? The biggest head of expenditure for the government is spending on infra, salaries, pensions. The total of this salary, pensions and infra is close to 6 lakh crore rupees. 6 lakh crore rupees. This is the biggest head of expenditure for the government. Okay. The second head of expenditure is subsidy. Subsidy payout. Subsidies and specific schemes. So for example, Narega will fall here. So subsidies and schemes. This head is 4.8 lakh crore. Then you have defense. Defense, both equipment and operating expenses are like defense salaries, defense maintenance, those kind of expenses. This is 2.7 lakh crore. Then you have railways, 0.5 lakh crore. So again, Spandan, imports are not expenses of the government. Yeah, imports are expenses of the importer. Just like exports lead to income for the exporter, imports are expenditure for an importer. Government is neither importer nor exporter. Never. Yuvraj, planned and unplanned expenditure have finished off. So plan and non-plan expenditure was terminology which was used earlier. Now it has not been used. In fact, that is one of the three major changes in the budget this year. One, the date of the budget has changed from 28th to the 1st of Feb. Second, the rail budget has been merged. And the third, plan non-plan has been finished. And now we have revenue and capital. These are expected values for 17-18. I'll come to that cost up. Give me a minute. Okay. Now, first AK. Railway budget is not 2.7 lakh crore. It may be the case. However, please note, there's a difference. What has happened now is that the government has merged the rail budget and the union budget. However, the additional outlay, please note, the additional outlay from the government towards railways is only 0.5 lakh crores. The rest of the outlay or the investment will come from internal accruals. That means railways will make an expenditure of, let us say, 2 lakh crores, but the rest of the expenditure will come from the operating revenues of the railway. So whatever they earn, they'll have to spend from that. Additionally, this year the government is only giving them 55,000 crore rupees as fresh money. Okay, why have railway and union budget been merged? Frankly, they should have never been different in the first place. Just like defense or just like any other part of the government, any other operations of the government, this is part of the government's normal expenditures. Why should the railways have a separate budget? The railways have had a separate budget since the time of independence, because that was the way the Britishers used to outlay their finances. But it has not been changed. There is no reason for having a separate budget per se. The railways is as much a part of the government's expenditure as anything else. So in that way, even defense should have a separate budget. That way, even, for example, education should have a separate budget or healthcare. But these don't have a separate budget. So similarly, why should railways have a separate budget? I mean, there should be no separate budget anyways. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. This should have been done much longer back, but it has not been done for some reason. Nobody has taken the step. So there was no reason to have it separate anyways. Again, cost up, the revenue of the railways counts as income for railways. If railway earns money, they have profit and then they give dividend, that will be government income. Railway income is railway income, not government income. So electoral campaign budget is of political parties. Government has nothing to do with elections. There is no electoral campaign budgets there. Yeah, so Mohan, I'll talk about that. I'll talk about that 1 lakh crore also. Safety wala, I'll talk about that. So, AK, now the situation is that the railways currently are at about 94%, which means if a railway's annual expenditure is 100 rupees, after all costs, or rather all their costs included, their annual expenditure is 100 rupees, their income is 94 rupees. That means the current situation is for every 100 rupees spent, the railways are making a loss of 6 to 7 rupees. It's 93 point something. So that is the kind of loss the railways are making. However, the railways are earning 93 rupees. So that money is there with them. 93 rupees are there with them. So to support that 93 rupees, the government is saying, in addition to those 93 rupees, we'll give you some more money. That is this 55,000 crores. So that next year you can. So what am I saying? I'm saying you are spending 100, you are earning 93 or 94. I'll give you another 20 rupees, let's say, for example, so that next year you have 114 rupees to spend to create more railway tracks, to upgrade your railway stations, etc., etc. Right? So that is why the government gives this additional funding. So 94 rupees you are making, net net you are in loss, but you have made 94 rupees. So you have that in your pocket. Plus, I'll give you 20 rupees more so that next year you can spend 114. That is the current situation of the railways. Pratham, I can only go as far as the group goes, yeah. Yes, Shoaib. So, Election Commission gets an annual budget from one of the, that is part of the budget outlay. So, that is part of your expenses here in the first part, right? So, funding towards Election Commission, and that's a very small part. That is nothing. That is just about 100 crore rupees that is given to the Election Commission. Yes, Ashwin, in that sense, railway is an independent body, even though they are reporting to the government, their policy framework is dictated by the government, but their incomes and their expenses are a separate income and expense statement. It is not part of the income and expense statement of the government. Right? So, railways का अपना incomes होता है, अपना expenses होता है. There's a separate statement for that. Bullet trains, भूल जाओ रजोल. This year, bullet trains are part of dreams. They were always part of dreams, they're still part of dreams. Bullet trains, nothing. Yeah. So that's railway expenditure. Now, in addition to this, on the expense side, guys, if you'll note, on the expense side, there are two more expenses. One is interest payments. Okay, Vibhor, yaar, so like I told you, yaar, so they're getting 94 rupees. So now, if I have 94 rupees in my pocket, next year I need more money, na, to spend. So I need to create more infrastructure. I need to create more tracks. I need to create more railway stations. I need to create more Yatri Nivas. So I can't do it with 94 rupees. I need some more. So that is why every year government gives some additional funding, right? And that is why this 50,000 crores is extra funding, fresh money. 94 you have already. I'll give you 20 more. That's the kind of thing it is. Okay? Chalo. So interest payment. So the government every year borrows money, and why you'll just understand in a minute. So the government borrows money, and interest paid on those loans comes here. It's an expense. So that figure is 6.3 lakh crore rupees. Along with that, whenever you take a loan, there is a principal repayment also, and that principal repayment is 1.2 lakh crore rupees. Pritika, give me 2 minutes. Rajul, give me 2 minutes. Let me finish this, guys. Please hold your question for 2 minutes. Please hold all questions. Let me finish this, then we'll come to your questions. Yeah, so 2 minutes. So this is on the expense side. If you total this side up, if you total up all the expenses, you'll find this reaches 21.5 lakh crore rupees. This is the total expenses of the government of India for 17-18. This is 2017-18. ठीक है जी? Now, this side you will see falls short, right? So there is not enough revenue coming in to meet all this expenditure. So the government is earning just about 15.7 lakh crore rupees, and so therefore they need to borrow. So there is a borrowing of about 6 lakh. I think it's, yeah, 6 or 5.75 lakh crore rupees. हाँ, so defense 2.7 lakh ही लिखा है यार. Costa, what are you doing? 2.7 lakh crores. ठीक है? So anyways, just guys hold your questions. Again, guys, I'm repeating for the third time. Please hold your questions for 2 minutes. This is the borrowing which is done to meet all the expenses. And now borrowing, even though it is part of the income side, it is not actually an income. Please note, guys, this is not an income. This is a borrowing done to balance the two sides. So now your sides are balanced. Now you have 21.5 lakh crore rupees on both sides. So there is a net borrowing of 5.75 lakh minus 1.2, so which is about 4.5, 4.6 lakh crore fresh borrowing is there. Because 5.75 lakh you are borrowing and 1.2 lakh crore old loan you are repaying. That means net net you are taking about 4.6 lakh crore net. Okay? So that is the situation. Now, coming to the question Ankush has asked. Ankush, 6.3 lakh crore is interest on previous loans outstanding. Currently, India has close to 100 lakh crore loans outstanding. 100 लाख करोड़ से ऊपर लोन आउटस्टैंडिंग है इंडिया का. 100 लाख करोड़ के लोन के ऊपर आप 600 लाख रुपए, 100 रुपए के ऊपर 6 रुपए इंटरेस्ट दे रहे हैं लोन्स पे. इंटरेस्ट इज ऑन दैट एंड 1 रुपी यू आर रीपेइंग आउट ऑफ 100 रुपी लोन. डू यू अंडरस्टैंड नाउ? दैट इज द सिचुएशन. 6 लाख इज द 6 रुपीज इज द इंटरेस्ट. 1 रुपी इज द रीपेमेंट ऑफ दैट 100 रुपी लोन. ठीक है. नाउ आस्क मी गाइज, इज देर एनी क्वेश्चन ऑन दिस पिक्चर? दिस एफ आर बी एम एक्ट ऑल्सो मेन्शंस दैट द लोन टू जी डी पी रेशो. नाउ इफ यू नो द जी डी पी इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू दिस फिगर, नाउ एवरीथिंग शुड बी क्लियर. लोन टू जी डी पी रेशो शुड नॉट बी मोर देन 50%, आइडियली मैक्सिमम 60%. दैट मीन्स विद दिस काइंड ऑफ अ जी डी पी वी शुड नॉट हैव अ लोन मोर देन 90 लाख करोड़. आइडियल सिचुएशन 75 लाख करोड़. दैट इज वन ऑफ द रेकमेंडेशन ऑफ द एफ आर बी एम एक्ट. ओके. सेकेंड रेकमेंडेशन ऑफ एफ आर बी एम एक्ट दैट द फिस्कल डेफिसिट शुड बी 3% और लेस. ओके. 3% ऑफ वॉट? 3% ऑफ जी डी पी. रेवेन्यू डेफिसिट शुड बी जीरो. Now I'll explain what is revenue and what is fiscal deficit, then I'll come to your questions. Okay? So revenue deficit, very simply, is revenue receipts, these ones, minus revenue expenses. Revenue expenses are everyday expenses, operating expenses, which are not of the nature of infrastructure creation. Infrastructure is a capital asset creation. So accept that. So what are we saying? Salaries, pensions, subsidies, schemes, operating expense of defense. These are all revenue expenses. So revenue incomes minus revenue expenses, there should be no shortfall as per FRBM Act. Currently there is a shortfall. Finance Minister said, I will bring this shortfall to less than 2%. 1.9% is the targeted revenue deficit. Fiscal deficit is this figure. That is all incomes, all expenses, the relation between the two. So in effect your net borrowing. ठीक है. FMS targeted instead of 3% which was FRBM Act said 3%, FMS said I will bring the fiscal deficit to 3.2% of GDP. ठीक है. So that is the current fiscal situation. Now I'll come to your questions. Rajul, we have deficit budget because our expenses are more than incomes. Yeah, अगर आप देखेंगे our expenses are more than income, so we have a deficit budget. So borrow is your, so when I wrote borrow, I said this is what the government has to borrow from different sources to make sure that expenses are met. Because expenses are more than incomes, we have to borrow to make the rest of the expenses. So borrowing is a balancer between the two sides. Haan, so Kaustubh, that's fine. Yeah, I don't know if you know this, but in many countries, including all European countries, even US, borrowings are 3 times, 4 times GDP. मतलब अगर GDP 150 लाख करोड़ है, 400 करोड़ का डेट है, 400 लाख करोड़ डेट, 500 लाख करोड़ डेट. So as we grow, see the logic is simple, guys. The logic is you must earn that much revenue so that your daily expenses are met. However, if you want to create ports, bridges, roads, railway infrastructure, airports, schools, hospitals, if you want to create physical assets, you can borrow. In fact, it's healthy to borrow for creation of these kind of assets, for this kind of expenditure. So for infrastructure creation, borrowing is not a bad thing. But to borrow to pay salaries, to borrow to pay pensions, to borrow to give subsidies, that is unhealthy. So to borrow to create 8-lane highways, to create ports, bridges, schools, hospitals is fine. So borrowing is not a dirty word. It's fine as long as it is for infrastructure creation, right? So developed countries have GDP multiplied by 2, GDP multiplied by 3 kind of borrowing. India ka borrowing to kafi normal hai. So Rajol, if you don't if you manage in whatever you have, then okay, so how will you give subsidies? How will you give LPG subsidy? And mind you, one of the people who will be crying is you. I'm not getting LPG subsidy. I'm not getting subsidized. So when you go to a government university to study, you get subsidized fee. When you go to a government hospital, you get subsidized healthcare and medicines. When you go and buy LPG cylinder, you get a subsidized LPG cylinder. People who are poor buy subsidized kerosene. There are public distribution schemes for food. फर्टिलाइजर सब्सिडी, ये सब अगर नहीं मिलेगा तो हम लोग ही रोएंगे यार. सो हाउ विल दी सब्सिडीज हैपन, वन. सेकेंड, हाउ विल यू क्रिएट इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर? हाउ विल यू डू रियल रेलवे इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर क्रिएशन? सो यू नीड टू बोरो टू डू ऑल दिस. एनी कंट्री विच वॉन्ट्स टू बिल्ड गुड इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर विल नीड टू बोरो. ओके, दैट इज अ नेचुरल प्रोग्रेस. हाँ, सो वेयर डज बोरोड मनी कम फ्रॉम? Borrowed money comes from three sources, guys. Government of any country has three sources to borrow money from. One, government of any country can borrow from international organizations. So government of India can borrow from World Bank, not World Bank, but I can borrow from IMF. I can borrow from any other international organization like the BRICS Bank, for example. I can borrow money from a government. I can borrow money from government of China, right? So international sources. Second, I can borrow money from RBI. And third, I can borrow money from people. So when the government issues a bond or the government gives you a PPF account, Public Provident Fund account, essentially that is borrowing. Government is borrowing from us. So there are three sources of borrowing: RBI, people and international. Teen sources hote hain borrowing ke. Debentures government ne issue karti hai, Adarsh. That is a corporate does that. Debenture nahi, government bonds issue karti hai. Yeah, Mohan, that they do, but that is only for underdeveloped and extremely poor countries, largely for poverty and health reasons. So if there is a specific project, for example, polio eradication program, then World Bank will give you money. But not for developing ports and land base and you want to build a airport, World Bank will not give you money for that. World Bank will give you money for polio program, right? So IMF will give you money for infrastructure creation. Siddharth, again something that the budget document will tell you here, I have just given you an overall picture. Abhik, so how does money in circulation increase? Who prints money? The money is printed by RBI, Reserve Bank of India. So Reserve Bank of India cannot just print money. They have to print money and give it to somebody against. So when you see a money, you see a currency, there is a promise that you present this piece of paper, they will give you worth 100 rupees something. That's a promise by the RBI governor. So whenever money is printed, it has to be printed against something, right? So for example, the government will print a bond, the government will print a debt instrument, a treasury bill, and then against that the RBI will print money. RBI cannot just print money. Okay, so suppose the government does that, takes debt from RBI, what is the risk? This printing of money always leads to inflation. The more money is printed, the more the inflation will be. And again, that's unhealthy for the economy beyond a certain point. Sure, Siddharth, you saw that government defaults on securities have happened in Italy, in Spain, Greece. Yeah, so you have seen all these countries in the last few years who have defaulted on government debt. So that has happened. Yeah, Zimbabwe, absolutely. So हमने देखा है यूरोप में पिछले कुछ सालों में यही सब चल रहा है. हाँ चैतन्य, एब्सोल्युटली, यू एक्चुअली आंसर्ड योर ओन क्वेश्चन यार. सो व्हेन सप्लाई ऑफ एनीथिंग इंक्रीजेस, राइट, सो व्हेन द सप्लाई ऑफ मनी इंक्रीजेस, देयरफॉर पीपल हैव मोर मनी इन देयर पॉकेट एंड देयरफॉर पीपल आर विलिंग टू पे हायर एंड हायर प्राइस फॉर अ प्रोडक्ट, राइट. सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल, यू गो टू अ वेजिटेबल मार्केट टू बाय टमेटोज एंड टमेटोज आर 100 रुपीज अ केजी एंड यू हैव लिटिल मनी इन योर पॉकेट, द मनी इन योर पॉकेट इज लिमिटेड. So you will not buy, or you will buy lesser quantity. But if you have free flowing money in your pocket, you will be able to buy tomatoes at 100. The guy says 120, you will buy it at 120 also. Guy says 150 rupees a kg, you will buy it at 150 rupees. So more and more expensive things are there because you have money to pay. And so money supply always means ability to pay increases, and because ability to pay increases, inflation, prices of things goes up. Okay, Vipul, inflation is desirable, but to an extent, the RBI has recently come out with a set of guidelines where inflation should be in the range of 4 to 6%. So even inflation below, and we are talking about CPI inflation, consumer price inflation. So consumer price inflation in the range of 4 to 6%. What that means is inflation below 4% is also unhealthy. Okay? Because when we talk about GDP growth, it is a measure of both. So how do you, for example, grow? You grow with two factors. GDP growth always happens by an increase in output or by an increase in price. Right? So if I sell 100 units of a product, 1 rupee each unit, my sales are 100. How can I increase my sales next year? I can sell 200 units, or I can sell 100 units at 2 rupees. So either by increasing the quantity of output or by increasing the price, GDP can grow, economy can grow. So increasing price is necessary for growth. Okay? So that is why some inflation is actually good. And that is why the US Federal Reserve is looking at increasing interest rates, because they wanted the inflation to go up, and that is why they kept interest rates low. They increased the supply of easy currency. So inflation went up. Inflation went up was a target. They wanted inflation to cross 2%. Right? And so now they are saying inflation has reached comfortable levels. Now we'll increase interest rates. Right? So FRBM Pritika is a set of guidelines. So it is not mandatory. In fact, the FRBM Act is in process of amendment. The FM is sought to amend the FRBM Act as per the updated set of recommendations or the budget announcement. So they are increasing the tenure of the FRBM Act. FRBM Act said by 17-18 the fiscal deficit should reach 3%. Also, the recommendation was that the loan to GDP ratio should not be more than 50%, ideally maximum 60%. So they are trying to make those amendments in the FRBM Act. The government can do that. Since it's a money bill, it can be done. Okay? Okay? So this is the fiscal position. So the overall picture is that we are in a reasonably healthy position. We need to still work more towards more discipline fiscally. But yeah, our fiscal deficit is just about 3.5% now, and the target is 3.2% for next year. And similarly, the revenue deficit has been targeted at 1.9% of GDP. So these are good indicators. We are reasonably well managed in the fiscal position, in the fiscal position of the country. Loan to GDP is high, but even that we are trying to work on. As of now, in terms of the big economies of the world, we have one of the lowest loan to GDP ratios. So 65-70% loan to GDP ratio is about one of the lowest among the big economies of the world. So China, US, European countries, this is one of the lowest loan to GDP ratio. Revenue deficit right now is about 2.7-2.8%. Yeah, you can check the exact figure. Right. So now I'll come to the industries. Absolutely, Abhik. So again, those are idealistic scenarios. If our tax revenue goes up, if our PSUs perform better and they have more profits and therefore they give more dividends to the government, revenues will go up and therefore our deficit will reduce. But that's an idealistic scenario. That is something which, I mean, right now it's a wish, it's a theory. Right now that's not there. But yeah, it can happen. Okay? So let me come to the other announcement. This is just the fiscal part. The other thing which I briefly alluded to in the beginning of the session is that this is a Robin Hood budget. Basically, the major takeaway that I found was that the government is intending to take from the rich and give to the poor. So the tax benefits which have been given are largely targeted to a specific segment. So it's not a tax gift which has been given to everybody. The FM has said that the tax, the decrease in tax rate from 10% to 5% will only happen for those people with an income between 2.5 to 5 lakhs. When you are getting an income above 5 lakhs, there is a small reduction of 12,500 rupees. But in terms of your total tax, that's peanuts. So for example, if I have an income of 10 lakh rupees, right? So assume I have an income of 10 lakh rupees. My total tax outgo was about 1,25,000 rupees up till now. So I was paying 1,25,000 rupees tax on an income of 10 lakhs. Now with the new announcement, I will be paying a tax of 1,13,000. So I have a definite impact of 12,000 rupees, but in terms of my percentage, so 1,25,000 tax de rahe the, ab 1,13,000 hai. That means I am saving just about 4% of what I was paying earlier, right? So it is not a very huge amount. Okay, yeah, Yuvraj, that is something that a lot of people have a misunderstanding on. The tax slabs have not changed. It is not 3 lakhs now. Absolutely not. It's something which is a very wrong understanding. There is a specific section, you can check it out yourself, 87A, in which people earning income up to 5 lakh rupees get a rebate of 5,000 in their tax. People earning above 5 lakh rupees, there is no rebate. So only this 3 lakh, up till 3 lakh that you are saying, this is only for those people who are earning up to 5 lakhs per year. People earning above 5 lakhs a year, there is no change in the slabs. Okay. So this is the other implication that, you know, the tax benefit has been given, but it is a good benefit only for those people which are earning between 2 lakh, 3 lakh, 4 lakh, that kind of a level of figure. People who are earning above that, there is not a very big benefit in terms of individual income tax. In fact, for people earning above 50 lakhs, there is actually an increase in tax, right? So again, targeting specifically the lower income and the lower middle income, and taking from the rich, giving to the poor, right? Similarly with the corporates, yeah, the rebate has reduced, and we are absolutely right. That section 87A, the rebate was 5,000 rupees earlier, now it is 2,500 rupees. Absolutely right. Okay, surcharge is always levied on tax, yeah. It is a levy on the tax. Rebate is a specific section, yeah, on section 87A. You can check out on the internet. Section 87A gives rebate of 5,000 rupees to those people who are earning up to 5 lakh rupees income per year. And now that amount from 1st April will reduce to 2,500 rupees. So rebates have been reduced, but the tax rate has gone from 10 to 5% for income up to 5 lakh rupees. Okay, Ashwin, I'll do that. Give me a little bit of time. Let me cover the major points. I'll come back to this. Along with that, the other major announcement related to taxes is that the small and medium enterprises, that is those enterprises with an income of up to 50 crore rupees, the tax, income tax has gone from 30% to 25%. So again, small companies with up to 50 crore turnover have got this benefit, where their income tax is now 25%, not 30%. How will this help? The expectation is that these people are generally good amount of job creators. They create a good number of jobs, and therefore, if they have to pay lower tax, more jobs will get created in the SME sector. Okay. However, my understanding is that smaller companies generally have more employees of semi-skilled and unskilled nature, right? So the skilled labor, all of you who are doing MBA or planning to do MBA, will not work in companies which have up to 50 crore turnover. There will be very few of you who do that. Most of you will be working in larger companies. So similarly, people who are, you know, technical education graduates, people who are professional postgraduates, generally don't work for companies with less than 50 crore turnover. Less than 50 crore turnover company, let's say a small company in Ludhiana, will have 50 people in the office, so skilled labor 50 people, and they'll have 500 people on the shop floor in the factory, unskilled and semi-skilled labor. So the larger job creation will happen at the semi-skilled and the unskilled level. That is in fact one of the major problems with the budget this time. In terms of skilled job creation, for skilled jobs, there is actually no announcement. There is nothing for creation of skilled jobs. For semi-skilled and unskilled jobs, there are incentives, there are pushes. There have been various announcements related to semi-skilled and unskilled job creation. But for skilled job creation, people who are doing MBA, people who have done engineering, people who have done professional qualifications, there is no major announcement as such. That's the whole idea, Ashwin. So what is happening in these small and medium sector enterprises is that they have a few office employees, accountants, clerks, right? So people who are graduates, that kind of, so there will be like 50 people working in that office, but there will be 500 people who are working as contract labor, who are working on the shop floor, who are working after doing 10th or maybe not even doing 10th. So the unskilled and the semi-skilled labor is far more in these companies than the skilled labor. So yeah, unskilled, semi-skilled, they have given a push because these companies now pay lesser tax, they'll employ more people. That's the idea. But this will benefit the unskilled and the semi-skilled labor. This will not benefit people like you and me. Ashwin, that is one thing that you must always remember about this particular government. This particular government is very smart with numbers. So this 94% figure that Jetli threw is just complete nonsense. So yeah, so the number may be true, right? The number may be true, but there'll be a lot of companies which are just registered, which don't even work, right? So yeah, 94% jo companies hai, a lot of registered companies are even have already shut down and actually doing no business. They're just registered entity with the Companies Act. So actually, agar aap dekhen, ye number itna bada nahi hai. Even though it sounds like achha, 94% of all business. That's the first thing. The second thing is in terms of value, the contribution to GDP is not as much as, so they are 94% in number, but the contribution to GDP would be about 25%. 75% contribution of GDP would come from those 6% companies only. So the benefit has not really been given to a very big number as it is. So this government is very smart with numbers. Please don't trust the numbers blindly. Others, it's not 1%, but income tax returns, income tax data shows that out of 125 crore people, close to 4 crore people pay income tax, or rather not pay income tax, file income tax returns. Some of them pay zero tax also, just file the return and declare a zero taxable income. So 4 crore people, which is close to 2.5% or maybe 3%, pay or show an income tax return. That's the number as per income tax records. So yeah, that's the situation. That is a fact. That is true. Okay, so that's the other announcement. So again, both of these things are specifically meant to help the poor salaried taxpayer who is earning 2, 3, 4 lakh rupees, or it is meant to help the small companies. And again, by targeting, taking money from the rich, this is being done. The third big change which has happened in this budget is regarding poll funding. Political funding. So political funding, there have been a couple of announcements, noteworthy announcements. One is the issue of electoral bonds, okay, where it is proposed that the RBI would issue electoral bonds. If I want to make a donation to a political party, I can go to RBI, buy this bond and then give this bond to the political party as a donation. That political party goes to the RBI and takes the cash. So it is like a bearer demand draft. So I can go there, take a bond, and then without declaring my name, without declaring my intention or my loyalties, I can go and give it to that political party. The bond will be a bearer instrument. It will not have a name or anything, right? So then the political party goes to the RBI and gets it encashed. So that's one. This will help in reducing the cash donations for those who want to pay to a political party but still want to not come as a name. Jinhone naam nahi dena, right? So that's one. The second is regarding the cash funding. So cash funding of political parties has been limited to 2000 rupees. I think that is not something that will help in any way, because the only way this can be checked is through the entries that a political party makes. So for example, I have a political party. You come to my office and you bring 1 lakh rupees. What will I do? Instead of putting one entry, I'll put in 50 entries. Yeah. That 50 people came today and then gave me 2000 rupees each. What's the problem? So in terms of accountability, in terms of implementation, I don't know how this will be done. I don't think it is possible. A political party who wants to show 50 entries instead of one can do that. Yes, absolutely. So just the more receipts have to be made. What is the problem with that? That can be done. Yeah, absolutely. So it can be done if the intention is there. So one, the electoral bonds is a good step. The second is that all registered political parties now have to get the income tax audit done. They have to file income tax returns and get an audit done, and which is now a good step. So it will become tougher. You have to file income tax returns and you have to get audit done. So it will become tougher to answer questions. So even then it can be done, but it becomes slightly tougher, right? So that's the other thing. So Ashwin, why not completely say so? If the Prime Minister and the Finance Minister since the last 2 months are talking about digital transactions, why don't you make political donations completely cash free? No cash allowed at all. Why not? So, for example, if I have an inclination to help a particular political party, I can use check, I can use a demand draft, I can use my, the swipe cards. So they have talked about Aadhaar-based payments now in this budget. So instead of everybody, the 100 crore people have Aadhaar, they keep boasting about that. Why don't you have Aadhaar-based payment machines at the electoral offices, at the political parties' offices? Why not? Yeah. So if cash, if people don't want to pay cash, suppose I have a person who's, lower middle class. I don't have credit cards, debit cards. I can still pay by check. Chalo, I don't have a bank account. I can still pay by Aadhaar based system. There are ways. So completely eliminating cash was an option, right? So that is something that could have been done. But yeah, so implementation in this way would be suspect. Okay, that's the second thing. Next, another major announcement was FIPB. So those of you who know, the Foreign Investment Promotion Board is going to be phased out. The Foreign Investment Promotion Board was a regulatory body which monitored the FDI flows coming into India. So FDI flows coming into India came by two routes. One was the automatic route, one was the FIPB route. So the FIPB as a body is going to be phased out in the next year or two. And this is good because FIPB route was a very complex, cumbersome, time-taking route. FDI coming through that route used to get stuck 9 times out of 10, right? So instead of FIPB, a new body is likely to be introduced where hopefully the FDI laws will become simpler. So there are steps, there are indications that FDI laws would be made easier, simpler. So foreign investment coming into India is likely to be encouraged with this step. Any auditor, Abhinav, so any registered auditor, so for example, any auditor which has, which is authorized to by the ICWA, by the audit committees, they can register the political parties. There is no government auditor. So for example, the CAG audits the books of the government of India. It doesn't audit the books of political parties, right? So that is done by any private auditor. So that's one. Next is that housing. So housing, there have been some good announcements in the sense that affordable housing has been made easier. The area for qualifying as an affordable housing project has been relaxed. Also, affordable housing has been given infrastructure status. Both of these steps will help companies get into the affordable housing business and therefore get cheaper loans and easier investments into their business, right? So companies like DLF, any construction company who wants to get into the affordable housing market, it becomes easier now. Right. So again, the target of the government is to have affordable housing for all of Indians by 2022. And so there are steps which have been taken towards this end also. So Yuvaraj, FIPB, it's not a set of recommendations. No, FIPB is not a recommendation body. FIPB is a regulatory body where they provided FDI clearances. So for example, if Walmart wants to come to India and do business, they will either come in with automatic route if they qualify. There are some qualifying norms. And if they don't qualify, they'll go into the FIPB route. So now FIPB has a very complex set of laws, very cumbersome procedures. And generally, FDI used to get stuck in FIPB. And so therefore, FIPB ke through aari hai, wo aahi nahi paati thi. Right? And so that was the problem with FIPB. Automatic route is, like I said, Divyansh, so there are certain norms. For example, there is a norm on minimum amount of investment. There is a norm on the sector in which the investment is being made. And then there is a norm on shareholding pattern. So ye norms jo qualify karti hai companies, they used to come in automatic route. All other companies used to go the FIPB route. Okay. So Disha, yeah, I'll come to infrastructure. So when I say affordable housing was a project, a dream project of Narendra Modi. And he talked about housing for all by 2022. Okay. So this affordable housing term essentially was defined as a house which is built up area of 60 square meters. Okay. And so any houses which is bigger than that cannot be called affordable housing. Any house which is less than 60 square meters built up area was considered affordable housing project. Right. So essentially these affordable housing projects used to get cheaper loans from banks, used to get investment through insurance companies and other bonds and bills, and they used to get more money. Now, two things have happened. One, the affordable housing, instead of 60 square meters built up area, has been redefined as 60 square meters carpet area, which basically means, in simple words, larger houses can come under the category of affordable housing. That means more housing projects will get cheaper funding. Secondly, affordable housing has also been given infrastructure status. So infrastructure jo projects hote hain, they get even cheaper loans, they get financing. So for example, when a LIC takes money, when you buy a life insurance policy from LIC, where does LIC put that money? That money which you pay to LIC, there is a list of investments which they can make. They cannot go beyond that list. One item in that list is infrastructure projects. So insurance companies by mandate have to invest in infrastructure projects. Similarly, government bonds, whenever government picks up money from you, one of the areas they have to invest is infrastructure. So whenever money is raised by insurance companies, by government through borrowing, one area which is mandated for investment is infrastructure. So infrastructure gets a lot of funding in India. And so if affordable housing gets infrastructure status, there will be a lot more avenues from which money will come. Right? So affordable housing being given infrastructure status and affordable houses, the size parameters changing, both means that more money will flow to affordable housing and the money will also be cheaper. Right? So this is what it means. Yeah, second house, this is basically a tax benefit which you get for second house, but that has not been changed. There is no change in that because the government thinks that this leads to a tax avoidance. So there is no change in the law related to second house. There is a tax benefit which is given. Okay? So that's the other good thing in. So the good things in the budget, one, fiscal deficit has been maintained 3.2%. Second, political funding and the electoral bonds. Third, FIPB to be abolished. Fourth, the housing, lot of incentives for housing. Right? So these are the few good outstanding announcements in the budget. Few drawbacks. One, like I said, there is nothing in terms of formal skilled job creation. There is no announcement, there is no layout for this. Secondly, there is no rationalization or reduction in food and fertilizer subsidy. Right? So the food and fertilizer subsidy, which is a very huge chunk, so agar aap subsidies dekhe, which are about 4.8 lakh crores, a very big part of this is food, fertilizer and oil. Ye teen badi subsidies hai government of India ke, right? Oil may be, if you look at it, it's largely LPG, kerosene and to some extent diesel. Okay, so food, fertilizer, oil. So in mein agar aap dekhe, food, fertilizer, mein there is no movement. We still have those subsidies, we still have leakages, and there is no action taken to rationalize these subsidies so far. That is one big miss. Another big miss is that the layout, the funding going towards public sector bank recapitalization is only 10,000 crores, which is a very small peanuts kind of an amount. So what has happened after demonetization, agar aap dekhen, and I'm sure you would have heard, after demonetization, the biggest impact has come to the unskilled labor class workers. So the people who were getting a lot of cash payments, that is where the biggest impact has come, right? Not so much on your home or my home. There was a temporary blip, but then things smoothened out. But the people who were doing manual labor, people working in factories, people working in housing projects, construction projects, they were the one who were affected the most, right? So again, because of this, the small and medium enterprises who were taking microfinance kind of loans, they were the ones who were most affected because their business was largely driven in cash, right? And so loans given to these organizations, small and medium companies, have started showing up as NPAs. So the banking system is going to show a lot of NPAs in the next 1 year. Last 1 year was bad for Indian banking. Next 1 year is going to be even worse. Because the loans given to these kind of small units, which had a lot of manual labor, where the payment and even income was in cash largely, they have suffered drastically. And so over the next 6 to 8 months, you will see banks showing extremely high NPAs very poor results. And so bank NPAs are going to shoot up. Banks will need much more money than 10,000 crores. Right? So that's one big miss in the budget. Yeah, I'll talk about that a bit. Give me 1 minute. That's a third big miss. So one is on formal job creation. The second is on the food and fertilizer subsidy. The third is on the public sector bank NPA crisis. Okay. A few other talking points. One is regarding the universal basic income. Now, some people were expecting the universal basic income, but some experts were already saying, and I agree, that this is a very half-baked, premature idea for India right now. It is not feasible in a country like India. So if you were to apply universal basic income, for example, one of the estimates says that this will lead to an outflow of 4 to 5% of GDP. So agar aap abhi dekhenge, this subsidy and schemes, this one, this is already about 3-3.5% of GDP. If I were to actually remove all this, completely remove, and then also start UBI, that already, so that's 5% of GDP, that's 6 lakh crores or 7 lakh crores. Actually, I'm increasing my expenses by 2-3 lakh crores. Where is the money? So as of now, given where our tax revenue stand, we don't have the budget, we don't have the allocation for UBI. That's one. Second, we also don't have the IT backbone infrastructure to monitor this. There will be a lot of leakages. There will be a lot of people taking advantage of the UBI scheme because our technology backbone is not strong. So UBI is too soon. It is too soon for a country like India. It is not a good idea. It is far too premature. Yes, Adarsh, Finland has experimented with this. Right. So that's one. Second is NREGA. So NREGA, the outlay has gone from 38,000 crores to 48,000 crores this year. But you must understand this figure. Actually, there is no increase per se. Actually, the NREGA plan last year was 38,000 crores, but the actual expense under NREGA was 50,000 crores. So this year, actually, when you are giving 48,000 crores, there is no increase because your last year actual expense was already 50,000 crores. So there is no increase in NREGA outlay. Okay. The other thing about NREGA that you should know, unlike the UPA, where NREGA was a generic work program, so anybody who wants to work will get some work. Somebody will be cleaning the roads. Somebody will be digging, for electricity poles, they'll be digging holes. Somebody will be engaged in smoothening of traffic. Somebody will be doing something else. So there was all kinds of work happening under NREGA 2-3 years back. But now there is a clear mandate from the center to all states that funding under NREGA will only flow for infrastructure of irrigation. So when you are creating irrigation infrastructure, that will qualify as NREGA employment, nothing else. So now the emphasis is on irrigation infrastructure creation. So essentially, the NREGA outlay, 50,000 crores, is basically irrigation outlay. Okay, so that is the change which has happened, and actually that's also a good thing. Yeah, that's NREGA. The other thing which has happened this year is the announcement of the oil PSU. So the FM has announced that they will attempt to create a single unified oil public sector unit. So that means, in other words, GAIL, ONGC, IOC, HPCL, BPCL, all will be merged into one entity. Now, the obvious reasoning behind this is that larger scale will lead to, or hopefully will lead to, global competitiveness, competing for global projects. Larger size will give them all research and development advantage. They'll be able to cull out the best resources from the world and fight with other giants for this. That's the idea. However, there are going to be challenges if this is done. If a single PSU is created, a huge giant like this is created, this will lead to further slowing of decision making. This will lead to increased corruption, and this may also lead to cultural conflict between the employees. So it is not so easy to create a very big behemoth like this, to create a giant like this. There are going to be challenges. So challenges will be corruption, challenges will be slow decision making, and challenges could also be cultural conflict. So Ashwin, because there has to be a plan, no? So when you are doing this entire exercise, this fiscal exercise of revenues and expenses, there has to be some logic that I'm going to get some money. This is where I plan to spend it. So I've overshot it is another thing, right? Similarly, you have incomes also. So FM keeps on saying that we have overshot our indirect tax collection target. So, yeah, you can overshoot or undershoot your expenses and incomes, but there has to be a number to plan, to step, to start from, right?
ठीक है, सो दैट्स ऑन द ऑयल पीएसयू.
Another interesting announcement this year is regarding the listing of the railway companies. So the FM has announced that the railway companies like IRCTC are going to be listed this year, and the entire thrust of the budget has been this year that the rail ministry is largely going to be hands-off kind of a thing. So the dealing is hands-off, where the railways will get that additional 50,000 crores from the central government, but they are going to be free to decide where they want to invest, what kind of infrastructure they want to build, what kind of railway stations they want to modernize, and work on health and cleanliness. So largely, the thought process is autonomy. Similarly, if the public sector, if these rail companies are listed and get public shareholding, this will lead to autonomy as well as accountability, right? So public sector units will become accountable to the general shareholders, and therefore things may improve. That is the thought process. So again, that is something which is a good step. Listing of the publics, the railway enterprises. Couple of other announcements. One, there are some incentives for digital payments that have come in. That has already been flowing in the last couple of months. Announcements related to incentivizing digital transactions have come. Also, there is a cap on transactions in cash above 3 lakh rupees. So there is a thrust towards digitizing payments and receipts rather than cash. There are a couple of new AIIMS institutes that have been announced. No IIMs, thankfully. Labor reform. So the government has, yeah, that's another important point. Okay. So labor reform, another important talking point is that even though labor laws are very archaic and old in India, very outdated, there have been certain announcements regarding this. So the government has proposed that they will have a draft labor law, or some changes in the labor law will be proposed, and that draft document will be circulated amongst the state. I'm sure some of you know that labor is actually a state subject, it is not a center subject. So labor law cannot be formulated by the center. Labor law have to be formulated by the states. And so the center can only suggest and recommend changes in law. It is to be circulated amongst the state, and then it is up to the states to apply or implement them or not. So that is something the government is planning to do this year, suggest a set of changes in existing labor laws. Right? So that is largely the major pros and cons. So again, if you see in the shadow of demonetization and the shadow of Donald Trump and the slowing world economy, this has been largely an incremental budget. There have been no big bang announcements. There have been no game-changing reforms announced in the budget. There have been incremental steps. Largely, these incremental steps are good. There are some weak areas. Like I told you, one of them is the banking NPA or the recapitalization amount. One is on the food and fertilizer subsidy, and one is regarding the skilled job creation. These are the gaps which have been left. So, but there are a good number of positive announcements as well. All of them are incremental in nature, no big bang reform, right? So the central theme, if you were to identify, it is a Robin Hood budget, take from the rich, give to the poor, right? So that is about the budget. Largely, if you have any questions, please put it in the chat box. So Ashwin, your state and center subjects, you can easily check on Google. So just check out state and center subject issues in India, and I'm sure you'll get results. Even in Wikipedia, you'll get that. Yeah, so Pratham, education and health sector, they have been very nominal increase in the outlay. The increase is not, so like I said, it is not a very game-changing kind of budget. There have been no major projects or schemes in education or even healthcare. There have been nominal increases in the outlay towards these sectors, but that is not sufficient. Even defense outlay has just increased by about 10%. So there's a very nominal increase in these sectors. There is no game-changing scheme or project which has been announced: education, healthcare, or even defense. Ashwin, foreign investment in defense could be there. In fact, foreign investment in defense equipment manufacturing is allowed now. But there are, again, so the FIPB was a big threat. So defense sector in FDI was coming through the FIPB route, and which was a very big problem, because FIPB approvals are very difficult and cumbersome to come by. So again, now with the new proposed body, let us see and wait and see how the new body rules shape up and whether the FDI in these kind of sensitive sectors is made easier. Right. So as of now, it was very difficult, even though equipment manufacturing was allowed. So Abhinav, one way to look at it is that demonetization increased the liquidity with banks. But the other way to look at it is there demand for this liquidity? So the private sector is not borrowing more. So I was just reading yesterday, the credit offtake is absolutely stagnant in the last 1 year. So if I have money, but there is nobody to take the money, what's the use of the money? So that is the problem with the banking sector. That is one. And second problem which demonetization has caused, like I told you, banks which have given loans to the small and medium enterprises, microfinance, their repayments are stuck. So the bank NPA rise is going to be very sharp this year. Banks are going to face humongous NPAs over at least the next 2 quarters. Right? And so therefore, demonetization has actually caused more harm than benefits to the banks. So Vibhor, actually the seventh pay commission has actually been an expenditure which was, even OROP for that matter, which was accounted for largely last year. In this year's budget outlay, there has been no specific further outlay for this. Himanshu, you didn't understand your question, yeah? Demonetization and effort to compensate for dip in GDP. Okay. The government has done very little for private investment pickup in this budget. However, the investment that the government has proposed in infrastructure creation, the government has proposed investment in the railways and defense. So there is public sector expenditure which the government has done and has increased also. So investment in NREGA, investment in infrastructure creation, investment in developing road networks, there is an increase in allotment there. So definitely public investment the government has increased, has proposed to increase, but private sector pickup, government has not made any major announcement. So it is a 50-50 answer. For public investment, government is planning to do. Private investment, there is no major announcement except for the tax cut of the small and medium enterprises. Yeah, so Adarsh, 1 lakh crore jo safety budget hai railways ka, health and safety budget, that is basically included partly, that is going to be financed partly from the 0.5 lakh crores that you see here and partly from internal accruals of the railways themselves. So this 1 lakh crore is not going to come separately from the government totally. It is going to be financed partly by the government and partly by the railways themselves. Okay. So Ashwin, that is one of the challenges. Absolutely, you're right. The assumption, the notion that banks are working is that all this money which has come in will not go back out altogether. So for example, if 100 rupees have come in, people will not withdraw more than 50 once things go back to normal. That is the assumption and that is why interest rates have reduced, right? But however, if this withdrawal happens, MCLR will go up, the marginal cost of lending of banks will go up and interest rates will again go back up, definitely. But the interest rates have been lowered with the assumption that all this money will not go back out. See, Pratham, negative impact is what? Yeah, so the high income taxpayers will have to, bear this higher income tax surcharge. So yeah, definitely there is a problem there, but that number of people is less. So the government basically cares about noise, as you would have seen in Jallikattu, as you would have seen in the Nirbhaya case. Whenever there are 10 lakh people on the street, then the government does something. So because the number of these taxpayers is low, so chalta hai. So it's fine. That's the ideology, that's the thinking behind any government, any state government, any central government. Jahan pe 10 lakh log katthe ho jaye, they will do that. Right? And that's the way government works. That's the way politics works. Theek hai guys, so I think that's it for today. We'll close the class with this. Best of luck.